Good morning everybody and welcome to the second day of this workshop. As I had mentioned yesterday, this workshop is not about learning computer programming. All of the participant friends have been teaching computer programming to their students, so we expect that all of you are fairly good at C programming or C++ programming. However, this workshop is about teaching programming to students, and therefore in this session what I am going to discuss is the way we introduce computing to our first year students. I would like to comment here that the traditional syllabus of most colleges insists on first teaching the basic hardware concepts, then teaching something about compilers and operating systems, and then introduce programming. Most of us at IIT, and in fact many amongst you, would find this sequence unnatural. After all, to learn programming in a higher level language does not require any deep understanding of computer hardware or, for that matter, the underlying operating system and so on. This dilemma is not completely solvable, but the way we attempt to introduce programming to people here is we frame our own computing model using some extremely simple terms. I shall be covering that kind of approach in this session on introduction to programming. Along with this, we have prepared a few simple animations. Naturally, all the material will be released in open source, so we'll be uploading the animations as well as the lecture slides on the Moodle as well as on the home page. Please feel free to copy these, use these, and of course modify these if you so wish. So here we go. In this session, I'll introduce you to a computing model built around a hypothetical character whom we call Mr. Dumbo in English or Mr. Budduram in Hindi. We will describe the memory model that Dumbo uses. We will see how Dumbo interacts with us. Then we will look at the Dumbo's computing model, specifically how Dumbo executes instructions. And finally, we will describe the Dumbo's ability to store instructions, which is what makes a computer so different from any other gadget, because the computer is a stored program machine. That means it can store instructions and execute them one by one. So we begin by looking at our computing model. We introduce a character called Mr. Dumbo or Mr. Budduram. Here are two caricatures. The first one is a line drawing which I attempted to draw. The second one has been more professionally drawn by a graphics colleague of mine. We designate the Mr. Budduram or Mr. Dumbo as our computer, and we see how exactly Mr. Computer behaves. So here is the first set of observations about Dumbo's ability. Most important, we emphasize that Dumbo cannot do anything on his own, but can execute given instructions correctly. So that means Dumbo is not completely dumb or an idiot. He has the capability to understand our instructions and execute them. However, he is incapable of framing instructions on his own. He will act only when an instruction is given, otherwise he will not do anything. What are the abilities of Mr. Dumbo? We state that he can do arithmetic operations, logical comparisons, he can manipulate strings, and so on. Essentially then, he can operate upon and manipulate values and produce resultant values. This point is important to be emphasized. The Dumbo's sole objective in life is to get some values from us, manipulate them as per given instructions, and give the resultant values to us. That's all Mr. Dumbo does. Since the manipulation of these values involves logical comparisons, arithmetic operations, string manipulation, etc., we say that Dumbo can compute. And in fact, we claim that Mr. Dumbo receives the name computer because he can compute. This is essentially the introduction to our Mr. Dumbo's as a computer model. But the computing model or the programming model needs to be described in simplistic term, which we now proceed to do. First, we introduce the notion that Dumbo has assistants. It is important to indicate to our students that unlike in the old days, there used to be a central processing unit comprising a control unit, an arithmetic and logic unit. In short, a single CPU connected to memory, disks and so on, something that we shall discuss later in the course as to how to describe that to our students. But that was the old style model. Today, practically every component of the computer that you can think of has its own processor, has its own embedded software. For example, you take a terminal. The terminal is almost a full-fledged computer in its own right. It not only captures keyboard strokes, but it converts them into ASCII characters and communicates back with the central processor or the server. You take the monitor, which is able to display whatever we wish to display, but the monitor today is a full-fledged graphic computer capable of handling graphics locally. You take a disk, the disk is connected to the machine through a disk controller, which embeds very sophisticated algorithms to handle this. Consequently, there is not a single computer that we speak of, but actually a collection of computers. How do we describe this complicated notion to our students on the first day? The path that we take here is to say that we have one Mr. Dumbo and he has several assistants. One assistant can do arithmetic operations, another assistant can do input-output, a third assistant can do something else like displaying values and so on. In fact, later on we use this notion to introduce software hierarchy also as a series of Dumbos. So operating system is a Dumbo, compiler is a Dumbo, all these Dumbos together constitute the super Dumbo, who is our main computer. That is roughly the model that we enunciate. I am explaining this to you. However, at the level of the first year students in the very first lecture, you need not really introduce all these complications. In fact, the operating system, compilers, hardware, and such words, according to me, need not be mentioned at all, because the first year students are merely required to understand the programming concepts in the higher level languages, which we propose to do. As I mentioned earlier, the notion of these multiple Dumbos representing different computers need not at all be stated in the first lecture. You only say that Dumbo has assistants, and we shall see the use of these assistants in due course of time. We now proceed to define the computing model for this Dumbo. First and foremost, we emphasize that Mr. Dumbo has very poor memory. Dumbo cannot remember anything in his head. It is important to mention this because most of our students are used to doing mental computing. So they can add 5 plus 4 in their mind and come up with number 9. And if you say 5 and 4, both of them can remember 5 and 4 as distinct numbers in their heads. Since they can remember, they believe that Mr. Dumbo, who looks like a human being, can also remember things in its own head. However, since we are trying to depict a computing model with Mr. Dumbo, we have to emphasize that Dumbo cannot remember anything in his head. So if Dumbo cannot remember anything in his head, how does he remember anything? Because without remembering, how can he do manipulation of numbers? So here is our computing model. We say that while Dumbo has poor memory, he uses some kind of a cupboard with drawers as memory. So instead of keeping things in his head, Mr. Dumbo keeps all the values which are to be manipulated, or the result of all such values, inside drawers which are part of a cupboard. We say that each drawer has a unique name. You will all appreciate that this is to introduce the notion of symbolic names or variable names later in the course. So each drawer has a name, a unique name which identifies the drawer. So So this is drawer A, this is drawer E, this is drawer F, etc., etc. At this stage, it is not at all necessary to indicate what is the largest value a drawer can contain and so on. The notion of word length, the notion of 2-byte values, 4-byte values, 8-byte values, a single byte character, etc., etc., should be introduced only later. At the beginning, it is adequate for our students to understand that Mr. Dumbo, who can manipulate values, can actually put values into something like drawers of a cupboard, where each drawer has a unique name. We then say each drawer contains some value. For example, a drawer can contain a number. So here we have shown number 437 being contained in a drawer which is marked B. And we say Dumbo's memory location B contains 437. Similarly, Dumbo's memory location F contains a string called Ranade. So we show here Ranade. Ranade, incidentally, is the name of my colleague and in fact my boss, Professor Abhiram Ranade, is head of the computer science department at IIT Bombay. This very clearly introduces to our students that Dumbo can store values, not only numerical values, but also character strings inside these drawers which represent the memory of the Dumbo computing model. We now notice some peculiarities of the memory. We state that each location can contain only one value and not multiple values. It is important to emphasize that because students who have a single mind, and the example that I gave some time ago, that if you ask them to add 5 plus 4, they will add it to 9, and they can simultaneously remember 5, 4 and 9 as three distinct values in the same single head. It is important to emphasize, having stated that Dumbo cannot remember anything in the head, but Dumbo has to use the drawers of a cupboard to store values, it is important to emphasize that every drawer can contain only one value. Multiple values cannot be put inside a drawer which has been named as A, B, C or whatever. The second thing that we state is that the values in these locations, which we have named as A, B, C or whatever, are normally unknown. And what do we mean by unknown? We said if they are not defined by us, they are actually undefined. So usually we represent such values by a question mark inside a drawer. A question mark means nobody knows what the value is. It is again important to emphasize that there is no situation that a drawer does not contain anything. This our students will find hard to believe, because when they compare it with the normal cupboards, there will be empty drawers. And if you open a drawer, you don't find anything, you say it is empty. We have to state that Mr. Dumbo's cupboard and the drawers are very peculiar. Every drawer always contains something the moment Dumbo comes to you with his memory. However, the contents are unknown to us because they have not been defined by us. So ordinarily we say the values in these locations are normally unknown. Now if they are unknown, how do the desired values get into these locations? And this is where we make perhaps the most important point of our computing model. We state that there are exactly two ways in which a desired value can get into the memory location. One way is we supply a value which Dumbo stores in that location. And the other way is Dumbo calculates some values using some power of computing and puts a value in that location. It is absolutely important to emphasize that there is no third way for a value to get into a drawer. I hope you will appreciate that while this model is extremely simple, it's very powerful. And in fact, this fact is often missed out by many students and some teachers. The power of an assignment statement which does computing and calculates a single value which gets stored into a memory location, and the power of the input statement which collects a value from us and puts it in the designated location is known to us. But what we often fail ourselves to appreciate, and therefore our students fail to appreciate, is that there is absolutely, absolutely no third way for a value to get into a designated drawer. If a drawer has been named as A, B, C, D, E, whatever, a value can get into a drawer by an input operation, or a value can get into a drawer by a compute operation. Of course, we don't state that as a compute operation and input operation at this stage, and that is why I use a simplistic language here, that if the values are undefined at the beginning, how does the desired value get into a location? We state that either we supply a value which Dumbo stores in that location, or Dumbo calculates a value and puts a value there. Of course, it is not clear to our students how do we supply a value to Mr. Dumbo or how does Dumbo calculate a value. To illustrate that, we continue with this simplistic model and state the notion of exchanging values with Dumbo. Notice that we are trying to introduce the basic input-output operation. We say that Dumbo uses a cart, which we call a data bus. Please note that the notion of bus in electronics hardware is something completely different from the notion of a bus that our students know. And in fact, the notion that our students know is more appropriate for the description that we are doing here. A bus carries passenger, a cart carries values, that is the equivalence. So Dumbo uses a cart or a data bus to move values in and out of his memory and with the external world, that is us. More specifically, he can put a value in a location as instructed or can copy a value from a location and give it back to us. Notice that by these simple words, we are implicitly emphasizing a very important point, namely that an input operation, which we shall describe later, which permits us to supply a value which our Dumbo carries in the cart and puts it in a location, will intrinsically destroy any existing value there, and the new value will sort of remain in that drawer. However, when we say he can copy a value from a location and give it to us, we are stating that the contents of that drawer from which an output operation will subsequently be done are not destroyed at all. They remain what they are. The Dumbo merely copies that value and gives it to us. So again, all this is, by the way, an explanation to our teacher friends. All this need not be stated at all. In the first lecture, one can only say Dumbo uses a cart or a data bus to move values in and out. Dumbo can put a value in a location as instructed or can copy a value from a location and give it to us again as instructed. So far we have not seen how to instruct Dumbo. But what we are trying to understand is how Dumbo does this exchanging of values with us and with his memory. We have shown here a numerical value. But now we say that Dumbo cannot do anything unless he is instructed. So what if we give him an instruction, C in greater greater B? You will wonder, why does this instruction appear here? Since I am trying to indicate the way we teach programming at IIT Bombay, our course syllabus, by the way, does not specify a programming language to be used. What we use is a mix of C and C++. You will observe that C in is actually a stream input command which can carry a value from outside world, that is whatever is typed on the terminal, into the computer's memory. So C in greater greater B is what we are saying here. Those of you who wish to introduce scanf or fscanf right at the beginning can do so. A better thing would be to write a small procedure using hash define which resembles read or input or some such word, to emphasize that the instructions could look very funny to beginners. We have added a few comments here in this slide. For example, we say why C in, why not input, why not read, why not get, because these are the English words which describe our intention best. After all, we are trying to tell Mr. Dumbo, take some value from us and put it in the location for B. In fact, it would not be wrong to replace this complete line by a simple English command, like take a value from us and put it in location B. However, we are trying to go as near computer programming language as possible, and therefore we directly use a very cryptic looking command right here. Subsequently, when we give an example of a complete program, people will see that the instructions in that program resemble these kind of explanations that we have given earlier about Mr. Dumbo's abilities and operations, and they can relate one to the other. Here, whenever there is a cryptic thing like this, we immediately add a comment, why do we have to use greater greater symbol? Now, this particular symbol, which says greater greater, is an intrinsic part of C++ input streaming using CIN. For C programming, we might use parameters of a well-defined function such as scanf. So there we can explain why %d, why %f and such things. In fact, I will leave that as an exercise for you to make your contributions. Suffice it to say then that we have introduced indirectly the notion of a cryptic instruction that will have to be given to Mr. Dumbo. But we are still relating our instructions to the simplistic computing model that we have observed earlier. Namely, Mr. Dumbo can take a value from us and put it in a memory location, or Mr. Dumbo can compute a value, or Mr. Dumbo can copy a value from a location and give it back to us. So in this particular case, the input operation is indicated by saying that Dumbo will collect a value given by us, take it to his memory cupboard and store it in location B. And we emphasize once again that any earlier value, including an unknown value, will simply be overwritten. So this states to the student that if there was a question mark or undetermined value in that location, that will simply get destroyed and will get replaced by the new value which we are putting there. Similarly, we emphasize or indicate the output operation. So we said Dumbo can output values from locations to us, and the instruction to do so is cout less less g, cout less less a, less less g, less less square, less less root. Now, all of these are actually valid C++ input statements. I, by the way, do not consider it improper to use the C in and C out statements in introducing these basic programming concepts to students. In fact, you can use read or you can use any other sort of instruction that you think will be understood easily by the students. It is useful, however, to use instructions which we will use in a later program. Most probably, the best strategy for all the participating teachers would be to use the basic slide set for introducing computing model, but replace all these instructions by proper C instructions. Because the crypticness of any instruction, whether it is C++ or C, will not be understood and appreciated by our students anyway. So it might as well be that we use directly the C commands or C instructions as examples here. All that is important for our students to understand at this stage is that Dumbo will simply copy values from his memory locations and present these to us. And another important observation that we make here is that values in the locations from which these are copied and given to us, the original values remain undisturbed. That means if a location contained say 430, the location will continue to contain 430 even though that copy of that value has been given to us. Then we introduce the notion of an additional feature. We say cout less less value of count is less less c. Observe that we are introducing the notion that we can display a useful string along with a value. So consequently, when Mr. Dumbo gives us the value of C, we know that he is giving us the value of C or value of count or some such thing. Later on in our programs, right from day one, we shall be using similar strings to emphasize that the output value belongs to such and such variable or such and such meaning. Having introduced that strings can be given to us as display, we try out some of the Dumbo's input-output capabilities. Here are two instructions that we have written for Mr. Dumbo. C out, give value for B. C in, B. The first one actually displays this string to us. The second one takes a value from us and puts it in location B. That part is indicated here diagrammatically, where let's say value 437 is given by us onto the terminal monitor here of Mr. Dumbo, and Dumbo simply puts that value in the card and takes it to the location B. Similarly, we say give the value for location F, and we say C in F. We are indicating that a character string is copied or is given by us and is taken and put inside the location F. However, just to add some fun, I have indicated here not a character string but simply the name Ranade. Now, to indicate that a character string is written differently in programming languages, not just as RANDA, RANADE, I indicate here in a jocular way, is Dumbo carrying Professor Ranade himself? Of course not. How do we distinguish between a string and a person himself? Well, we distinguish that by putting a string symbol. So there is another repetition of this slide which says give value of F, and this time what is being given is a character string enclosed in double quotation marks. I have found that this simple example permanently etches in the minds of our students that character strings have to be written in quotation marks. Just to indicate that this is now happening correctly, we have shown a smiling Dumbo here like a smiling Buddha. Now we look at Dumbo's computing model. So if two numbers are stored in drawers A and B, say 35 and 12, Dumbo can add these and store the result in another drawer, say sum. Observe that we are now using this simple model to illustrate to our students the notion of an expression, the notion of an assignment statement, and the fact that after assignment statement, the value of the left-hand side variable will now change and will reflect the value of the expression on the right-hand side. Again, in our first lecture, we do not mention the notion of expression. We do not use the word assignment statement. We merely say we are instructing Dumbo to compute the sum of two numbers. And we say that two drawers contain two values, and these values are to be added. Another important point will be indicated in the process of calculating these sums, which we shall see in a moment. We first say that we instruct our Dumbo to do this computation by saying sum equal to A plus B. It is quite tempting for us to emphasize that this is an expression evaluation, this is an assignment operation, this is not an equation, etc., etc. I submit that we should desist from doing any one of these things in our first introductory lecture. And that is because the notion of syntax of a computer programming language at the higher level is not very easily understood immediately after the when the students come for our first lectures. It is useful therefore to continue with the Dumbo's model, where we say we give an instruction to Dumbo and Dumbo follows that instruction. It is adequate at this stage to say the instruction that we give to Dumbo to compute the sum of two numbers. Let's go to the previous slide. We have already indicated that we have two numbers stored in drawers A and B, and we want Mr. Dumbo to add these numbers and get the result in another drawer called sum. So the word sum, A, B, two values to be added, etc., has already been given in this slide. And therefore, in the next slide, when we just say that we instruct Dumbo by saying sum is equal to A plus B, students adequately understand this to be an instruction to Mr. Dumbo to add two values in drawers A and B and put the result in the drawer called sum. Ideally, I should have shown a value in A, value in B, and value in sum. In fact, an animation which I shall show you later illustrates this point. However, I had drawn this drawing, I remember, late night at 2 o'clock, and to open this drawer A, which was a line drawing, would have taken another 15 minutes, which I was tired of doing. Otherwise, A, B both should be shown as having two values. And the most important part, which I have shown here, of course, in this illustration, is that the sum contains a question mark. If there has been no previous instruction assigning a value to sum, indeed, the sum will contain an undefined value. And as we have indicated in our earlier slides, to begin with, Mr. Dumbo comes with a set of drawers which all contain undefined values. Therefore, it is appropriate to emphasize that before this instruction is executed by Dumbo, the drawer sum will continue to contain an unknown value or an undefined value as designated by this question mark. Now we illustrate something very important again, which will be explained much later in the course when we talk about hardware registers and the actual computing model and so on. We start by asking the question, how will Dumbo do this? What? How will Dumbo compute the sum of A and B and put the value in sum? This time we say Dumbo uses his assistant or junior Dumbos. The junior Dumbo, which is roughly the representation of our arithmetic and logic unit, by the way, we say that junior Dumbo uses rough sheets or registers. Incidentally, the register inside the computer's processor and a plain register that we are familiar with, or all of our students are familiar with, are fundamentally no different. These are pieces of paper in real life bound in a sort of volume which we call register, which we use for writing something. Here in the case of Dumbo, we say that junior Dumbo, who is an arithmetic and logic unit equivalent, will actually do the computation using some rough sheets or register. So we introduce the word register without going into the details of that register at all. We merely indicate to the students that register is something like a scratch pad to be used for doing these computations. But how exactly does the computation happen? Well, we suggest that what this Dumbo Junior does is he accesses the location A and will copy the value which is 35 into a register. Then we say Dumbo Junior will access the location B and will copy the value which is 12 into another register. Please note that when we are teaching higher level programming languages, it is completely useless to describe machine architecture as single register, two register, or a window of registers, etc., etc. All of this can come in due course of time. It is adequate to say that Dumbo uses registers, and since our students are familiar with multiple registers existing around them, they are comfortable with this explanation that Dumbo Junior accesses the location A, copies the value into a register, accesses the location B, and copies another value into another register. And then we say Dumbo adds these two values and the result is stored back in location called sum. Location sum will now contain value 47. This is perhaps a very important explanation from the perspective of actual computing that happens even inside a computer. But observe how easily it can be explained using Mr. Dumbo as a computing model. We illustrate this further using a line diagram. So here we say that junior Dumbo uses a set of local registers which are like working sheets kept on a table. So here we have some working sheets here which are kept on a table, and we have shown here directly the value 35 which was copied from A, the value 12 which was copied from B, and the final value 47 which is computed by Dumbo, which will then be put inside the location called sum. Observe that an animation which displays actually the sequence of events that happen in computing could be extremely useful. Our colleagues here have made one such animation which I shall show you in a moment. We emphasize that when Dumbo is done with this simple computing as instructed, A and B will continue to hold the existing values and location sum will now contain 47. Again, I have indicated B to continue to contain the value 12, and sum now has a value 47 instead of a question mark. At this stage, I would like to switch over to show you a couple of animations that have been prepared. But if there are any questions from the participating teachers, I will have a 5-minute interaction after the animations are seen. So here is an animation. Here is an animation where we are showing the different cupboards that Mr. Dumbo uses and how the input operation is done. Let us go over this animation once again. So when we show this animation, for example, it will be useful to actually keep talking about the animation verbally. So here we say, this is Mr. Dumbo. He has a set of drawers in a cupboard which are named A, B, C, D, whatever. We simply show the various drawers that can open and they contain something. Now here is an input operation. Dumbo is carrying a value 5 and this value 5 will be kept inside a drawer. So he opens the drawer, puts the value 5 inside that location, and the location C now contains the value 5. The Dumbo goes back. This is one illustration. I would like to emphasize that this is an extremely elementary animation which our team has prepared for this workshop in rather hurry. I think by seeing this, most of you will get ideas on how this animation can be improved. In fact, we look forward to such ideas from you so that we can incorporate them and make this animation better. Here is another animation that I would like you to see. This one illustrates the addition of two numbers by Mr. Dumbo. Input operations are shown where drawers A and B will now contain two values. The C is shown to contain a question mark. Now Mr. Dumbo takes the value 35, copies it into a register. The two registers are shown on a table. Mr. Dumbo then copies another value 12 from the location B and puts it in another register. Then Mr. Dumbo does computation, 12 plus 35 is equal to 47. And then this value 47 goes into a location called C. Now A contains 35, B contains 12, C now contains 47. I hope you will agree that such simple animations could explain the fundamental principles in computing in a much neater way. I would like to have now a 5-minute interaction with participants from different places. Is there a request from any center? Otherwise, okay, let's just go by the list that I see here. So can anybody point out an error, not a conceptual error really, but an error which if corrected can make the second animation better? There is also an error and there is a connectivity problem with our earlier slides in terms of semantics. Anybody would like to say something? Can we go to Badnera? They have a question.
Sir, error point of view, there is one error. You have not stored the third value in register. That is nothing but the location.
I think you have spotted the error correctly, but perhaps you are explaining it slightly differently. If you look at the animation, you are right in that the first value is put on a register, the second value is put on a register, the third value which is computed should also be put on a register. It was shown in the animation as if it was just lying on the table and was directly going into a location. As we all know, inside the computer, it doesn't happen like that. The computing is done using values in registers and the result also first goes into a register. In real life, in a single register or two register machine, the resultant value will replace one of the registers itself. However, we need not go into those complications at the first level. But having stated that Mr. Dumbo uses registers for doing computing, it is important to illustrate either in our line drawings or in animation that if a value A comes from the location into a register, if a value B comes from a location into another register, then the resultant value which is computed must also be first computed and put in a register on the table. And the Dumbo should be shown to pick up the result value from that register and put it in the memory location. Thank you and congrats for finding it out. that this is a semantic discrepancy. There is also another small discrepancy. In the slides, we had used the instruction sum is equal to A plus B, and consequently, the result was going into a location which we had designated as sum. However, in the animation, the animators have used location C instead of sum, which is not correct. Either we should change our slides to say C is equal to A plus B, or the animation should be modified to include the drawer name as sum rather than C. Thank you, MGM. Yes. Government Engineering College, Amrutapuri, sorry, it's not Government Engineering College. AAC has some comments. Oh, first we are going to Thrissur. Thrissur had some observation, yes. Somebody from Thrissur would like to say something.
We also noted the problem with the registers. That time he raised the hand.
Can we go over to Amrita Institute, who had some comments? Amrita Puri, AAC Amrita Puri.
Hello, sir. This is Praveena from Amrita Puri, sir.
Hello, Praveena. Good to see you.
You have said that sum is equal to A plus B in that expression, right? So, A will be having some value in the cupboard, and B also will have some value in the cupboard. In the C cupboard, it is actually a C cupboard or sum cupboard. It is actually a garbage value. So when we add it in the workplace, we have to put those values from the registers into the cupboard. So we have to replace the garbage value with the actual value 47. So how we can explain this to the student in a proper way?
Very good question. In fact, that is another, I would not say error, but a semantic discrepancy in the animation which our friend from Amrita Puri has found out. So let me suggest the following. If you remember, earlier we had shown both in our drawers in the line drawing as well as in the animation that the locations normally contain a question mark. The question mark actually represents a garbage value. What we ought to do in our animation is that when the final value 47 is being put inside the location C, then first of all, Mr. Dumbo should open the location C, look at the question mark, remove the question mark and throw it away, and then put the value 47 inside that. Perhaps that will explain the replacement of a garbage value with the correct result properly. Thank you very much. It's a very important observation that you have made. It will help us modify the animation better. Amrita CBE has one question. Let's go over to Amrita CBE.
Yes, Phatak, this is JC. I am attending this course all the way.
My God.
I just had one suggestion.
Yes, JC.
You got over the shock or yes?
Well,
you're still shocked.
I was so enamored by your kurta that I could not recognize you, Jesse.
Okay. Just a suggestion. I don't know. This is probably I am one of the unique chaps who is attending this course because I never have taught CS 101. So. Please forgive the kind of question that I'm raising. The whole operation, the whole animation and the slides contained one operation, arithmetic operation, which was not animated. When you take out the values from registers A and B, you put the values on registers A and B, then there should be some kind of juggling there, animated, such that you come out with 47. How does Dumbo get 47?
Yes.
That is the question.
Yes. Very good point. I think it's another excellent suggestion. But first of all, for the benefit of all 900 colleague teachers who are attending this workshop, let me mention a personal note. Professor J. Chandrasekhar has not only been my colleague for almost four decades, but he is also my guru bandhu. He was the first PhD student of Professor Kekre and I was the second one. And we have spent very exciting moments in this institute. I am sorry, JC, that I could not recognize. Perhaps you have worn a little less flunky kurta. I would have paid attention to your face. But anyway, coming back to the point that was being made by Professor JC, how is it that Mr. Dumbo suddenly gets 47 out of nowhere? It is indeed very useful suggestion, and perhaps what we could do is show the normal arithmetic that we do, 32 plus this, so you add the first digit and put that digit there and you add the second digit and so on. This will explain that Dumbo is doing some computation, but it will avoid getting into the details of electronic addition and so on at this juncture. Thank you very much, JC, for making an excellent suggestion. So we now go forward with, there is a request from SGSITS.
Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
I'm Mala Datta from SGSITS.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So my question is that, can we store the values A and B in same registers in different locations?
Okay. Electronic, yes, I understood your question. Let me repeat it. Mala from SGSITS is asking whether the two values can be stored in the same register. The answer is unfortunately no, because a register is exactly like a location. Just as a location can contain one value, one register can contain only one value at a time. It cannot contain two values. While we are not explaining the notion of electronic registers to our students at this stage, but it is important to subtly indicate to them that a register is no different from a memory location in the main memory. Only the electronics is different, as some of the students doing computer science or electronics will later on discover, or as we might explain to our students somewhere towards the end of this course, that registers are merely fast memory locations where data access, input and output to the registers can be much faster or between the registers. However, the point to be made at this juncture is that the answer is no. A register can contain only one value at a time, just like a location can contain a one value. I hope that satisfies your query.
Okay, thank you. Right. Then how many registers?
I will guess your question, Mala. What you are trying to ask is how many registers can there be inside a computer? While that digresses a bit from the introduction to computing principles, because we do not want to get into any kind of electronics at this stage, but just to answer your curiosity, in the very old days, computers used to have either a single register or two registers. In fact, the electronic circuits of the arithmetic and logic unit could actually perform a computation using one value in a register and one value directly copied from the location into its circuits, and the resultant value would get into that register itself, and you would have instructions at the machine level to load a value into a register from memory or to put a value of a register into the computer memory and so on. However, modern day computers have multiple registers. In fact, some processors have a large bank of registers, and not one bank but multiple banks. Later on, when you describe the notion of context switching, when an operating system is handling multiple programs, then the contents of all the registers which are stuffed with values from one program execution are simply swapped out to disk, and the other values pertaining to other program are brought in. This is what we will discuss when we discuss the operating system details, perhaps at an advanced level of computing course later. However, in actual practice, there are computers such as Spark processor, for example, which has actually multiple register banks, and you don't push the values of registers into a disk when you swap the contents. All that you do is shift the pointer from one bank of registers to another bank, and consequently, the time spent in context switching is reduced significantly. However, all of this explanation I gave only as an additional explanation to satisfy the curiosity of our teachers. I will repeat my request, please do not at all use any kind of electronic explanation in the first preliminary lectures to your students, because you are trying to teach them computing as done through higher level languages and not computing as is done electronically actually inside a computer at this stage at all. So in a nutshell, it is adequate to say that we have as many registers on the table of a computer or Mr. Dumbo as we may require for any computation. That would be adequate explanation. There was one question from SICSR Pune.
Sir, I am Prachi, and I wanted to ask whether the concept of L value and R value should be introduced right now, or will it be too early? L value and R value of a variable, like some will use.
At this juncture, we haven't even talked about the notion of a variable, and therefore it will be inappropriate to talk about L value and R value. I would like all of you to appreciate that in the first lecture, where we are trying to explain to students, many of whom perhaps would have never seen computer, and certainly most of them would not understand the intrinsic nature of calculations that happen in a higher level programming language. So I will once again state that our purpose in the first lecture is actually not to introduce higher level programming languages at all. Our purpose in this lecture is not to introduce the notion of expression and complicated evaluation. Our requirement is not to talk about an assignment statement, as we shall talk immediately in subsequent lectures. The first lecture is meant to give an extremely simplistic and yet a reasonably accurate model of computing as would be seen by a programmer when writing higher level language programs. We are not talking about higher level programming languages at this stage, except telling them that there are programming languages in which instructions would be issued to Mr. Dumbo. We have chosen very specifically simple instructions, such as an input operation, output operation, and a computation of sum of two numbers as the third operation. Here, we are not talking about an instruction in a conventional higher level programming language where a complex expression appears on the right hand side of the instruction, there is an equal to symbol, and there is a left hand side variable name. These notions will be introduced in subsequent lectures when we talk about variables, data types, expressions, and so on. The first lecture should be as simple as possible for everybody to understand, and once the basic concept is understood, we can expand upon them later on. I understand that there is another question. The lady is waiting very patiently. Please go ahead.
Good morning, sir. Thank you very much for giving me a chance. Sir, I want to ask the question, why C is called as a middle level language?
Okay, I can see that my friends, all the participating teachers are becoming more and more curious, and they want to get answers about all aspects of higher level language programming in the first lecture itself. But one mistake you made, lady, which I would like to point out, I requested that everybody should first identify oneself and then ask a question. Can you identify yourself so that all other participants also know you?
My name is Zana Taranum, working as a lecturer in Alana Institute, Pune.
Wonderful. Nice knowing you, and thank you for the question. Let me give you an answer. The answer is simply that the question is misplaced at this juncture. If some student asks you that, is C programming language, why is it called a middle level language? We should simply ask back, what is a language? What is a middle level language? We have not talked about any such things. We are talking about a Dumbo who is trying to follow our instructions to do some computing. And our answer should be, if such a question is raised by a student, that when we start discussing the C programming language, or when we start discussing programming languages in general, these questions will be answered adequately. In fact, I will see that you get an adequate answer to your question later, because there has been a lot of confusion on the middle level and things like that. To my own personal test, such questions are completely meaningless today. C is as good as a higher level programming language as any other programming language that you have. The correct answer is that using C programming, you can actually write programs which are very close to the hardware capabilities of a machine. And therefore, ordinarily a few things which you would do only at the machine instruction level or assembly level can be done almost similarly using C programming language. And that is why the C programming language by many stalwarts is not considered a full-fledged higher level language where you have only higher level abstractions and no ability to handle hardware directly. Since C can do that, C is sometimes called a middle level language. But let me assure you that this nomenclature of middle level language, etc., is rather ancient. Some of the textbooks still carry that nomenclature. I think in today's computing world, such nomenclature is completely meaningless. I also now understand that when we have 22 centers and people have queries, our timetable will go for a toss. But our friends from COEP have a question, so we should go over to COEP and see what they have to observe. COEP is not, we are not receiving data from COEP for some reason. Well, let me put it this way, let us stop this interaction for a moment. Let me complete at least this session very quickly and I will come back to you at the end of this session because I have two quizzes in this session. Ordinarily, I would have expected all participants to answer these quizzes using clickers, but since clickers have not reached everywhere, I will try to just ask these questions by posing them on the screen and then you can perhaps try and answer these as we go ahead. So let me go back and continue this session. We already made two important points about Dumbo's capability, that Dumbo can exchange values with us through instructions for input and output, and Dumbo can do simple computation such as adding two numbers. However, what we have not explained in this model to our students is how do we give instructions to Mr. Dumbo? The answer to that is attempted in the few sentences here. Firstly, we observe that most machines take one instruction at a time and execute it. So if you want to explain, for example, a machine like a fan, if you switch it on, it will start rotating. If you change the speed knob to another position, it will start rotating faster or slower. You give one instruction at a time, the machine obeys it. If you are driving a car, then you press an accelerator, the car will accelerate. You press a brake, the car will brake. However, there is no way to instruct a car that you accelerate for 3 seconds, then go steady for 5 seconds, turn right, then go steady for 3 more seconds, and then apply brake and stop. We will have to actually give one instruction at a time to the car will execute that instruction. And then, when we have given all the instructions in sequence, one by one at a time, then and only then the car may reach its destination. Unlike that, we say Dumbo is special. To this Dumbo friend of ours, we can write all our instructions in advance and give the entire lot to him. And this collection is called a program. We now state that Dumbo has a capability to store such a program. Note that this is the first time we are talking about a computer program. So far we are talking only about individual instructions and the ability of Mr. Dumbo to execute these individual instructions. We observe that Dumbo is very special. We observe that we can write all our instructions in advance and give the entire lot to him. So Dumbo is capable of storing the entire lot of instructions, such a collection which is called a program. Therefore, we say Dumbo has a stored program capability. At this stage, it may not be out of place to tell our students that in actual practice, the computers did not always have the stored program capability right from day one. Please note when I say day one, I am not talking about digital computers, but I am talking about electromagnetic computers. Perhaps some of you might want to tell a few historical notes, such as the Jacques loom cards or punch cards, which were used to store instructions. and subsequently the evolution of von Neumann architecture, because that architecture was the first architecture for digital computers which had the stored program capability. However, it is not necessary to go into the details at this stage. You can just say that Dumbo has a capability to store programs. From this point onwards, we consistently use the notion of a program, and we say all the instructions that we wish to give to Mr. Dumbo, we can write in advance, and the entire collection which is called a program can be given to Dumbo, and Dumbo can store this program. The natural question is, if Dumbo has only memory in terms of the drawers and cupboard, where does this Dumbo store this program? Because so far we have seen that the drawers store values which are exchanged with us or which are computed by Dumbo. And this is where we inform the students that, look, Mr. Dumbo uses the same memory to store our instructions as well. And we emphasize that Dumbo logically uses some space in the cupboard for storing data values and another separate space in the same cupboard to store instructions of our program. Logically, we can show these two as two separate cupboards standing next to each other, but it is important to emphasize that technically these two separate spaces are called instruction space and data space. We have found that the word instruction space and data space is very easily understood by students when given in the context of the same drawers and cupboards, by saying that some space in the storage area is used for storing data values and another space in the same storage area or cupboard is used to store instructions of our program. This is where, by the way, in the last two slides we have introduced the notion of a computer program, the notion of an instruction space and notion of a data space. Please note, however, that the instruction space is not in terms of binary instructions that actually a computer will store in his memory, but we are talking about instructions that we have written so far, like C in, C out, or sum is equal to A plus B. We tell our students that such instructions are written in computer programming languages, and our Dumbo is capable of storing these instructions and executing them. At this stage, it is not necessary to talk about compilers. At this stage, it is not necessary to talk about the fact that these higher level programming language instructions have to be first converted into machine instructions, etc., unless you have chosen the traditional route of first introducing computer hardware bits, the notion of machine instruction, assembly instruction, etc. I would like to mention here that there are multiple ways in which computer programming can be taught. In fact, the 900 plus teachers who have assembled for this workshop would have hundreds of different ways of dealing with teaching of computer programming. However, the most accepted norm for teaching higher level language programming is to first directly deal with the higher level programming instructions in a programming language without going into the details of hardware and machine instructions and such thing. All of these can be introduced at a later stage, but first it is important to form a model of computing in the minds of students and the model of instruction giving mechanism. It is adequate at this stage to state that instructions can be given using the instruction mechanism that we have just seen, and the fact that Dumbo can store all these instructions in advance and automatically execute them one after another is adequate to tell our students the notion of a computer program. The next few slides indicate a full-fledged program now. So here is a complete program. If you read this program, you will notice that this is actually a C program written in C++, except that instead of scanf and printf, we have used C out and C in. But this is a complete program. There are two comments here. This program takes two integer numbers as input and calculate their sum. Oh, there is a syntax error in English. This program takes two input numbers as input and calculates their sum should be the correct English. However, here again, I would like to suggest that this is the program that we show in our first lecture to our students. You might want to rewrite this program as a proper C program if your syllabus says that C programming language is the only part in the syllabus. Now, what we are doing is giving some kind of shock to our students. So far they were looking at a simplistic model called Dumbo, and suddenly a very cryptic kind of lines appear before us. At this stage, we may simply state that ignore the first few lines that you see in this program. These are required for a modern computing Dumbo to make sense out of all our instructions. And we say that at a later stage, we shall tell you more about what these lines mean. For example, include IOStream, or include mat.h, or include stdio.h. Such statements would be explained at a later stage. Using namespace std is a C++ command that will not appear in a C program. In fact, my request to all of you is to try to rewrite this and the next program in plain C such that it can still be meaningfully understood by students in terms of its semantics, if not in terms of its syntax, although the syntax has to be written correctly. So here we are trying to say int A, int B, C out, give two numbers, C in A, C in B, sum is equal to A plus B, C out, sum is sum and backslash n, return 0. There will be large number of questions that students will raise in their minds. Some of them will ask those questions. How do we answer those questions depends entirely on the approach that we wish to take. If we have already introduced the notion of machine language and assembly language, we can tell them about compilers, we can tell them about compiler directive such as include IOStream, we can tell them that C programs are essentially functions and each function returns a value. My own humble submission is nothing of that sort should be attempted in the very first lecture. But this program should be given, and in a lab they should be asked to compile this program and run this program. What is important is that our students appreciate that by writing instructions they can actually make a computer do useful computational work. Whether the program is cryptic in the first instance, yes, it is cryptic. To make more sense out of similar cryptic program, we typically use another example. So here is an example that I have constructed, which is a program to convert temperature from degrees centigrade to degrees Fahrenheit. This program looks very similar to the first program. It has a different comment so that our students understand that it is trying to do something else. It also introduces the notion of a float, float C, float F. Again, please remember, do not bother to explain in the first lecture what is float, what is int. Just say that all the symbols which appear, such as A, B, sum, C, F, etc., are nothing but memory locations, and they all contain numerical values. Don't bother to tell them the difference between integer numerical values and floating point numerical values in the first lecture. But let them just see this program and wonder what this does. They will all understand, by the way. This is what I have uniformly found with all our students, and you will find with all your students also. Once you tell them to neglect the sentences which they don't understand, they will figure out from this script that you see on your screen or a similar program that people will see on their computer screens that the two comments they will understand easily. They will understand the word C out and C in because we have explained those instructions earlier. They will understand F equal to C star 9/5+32. They will understand it implicitly that slash means division and star means multiplication without us telling them. Why? Because the formula for converting from centigrade to Fahrenheit is known to all of our students. And they understand that the centigrade value is to be multiplied by 9/5 and the value 32 has to be added to it. They will understand all this. They will understand C out F, but they may not understand backslash N. They will not understand return 0. It does not matter at this stage. Again, to conclude, I will say that introducing students to actual higher level language simple programs is best done by directly putting two simple programs in front of them, asking them to read, and then asking them specifically to ignore anything which they don't directly understand, and then ask them whether do they make sense out of it or not. You will find 95% of your students will say the first program adds to values and the second program converts actually from centigrade temperature value to a Fahrenheit value. And once in the consequent lab in the same day or the next day, if they are told to execute these C programs by compiling them and running them, and they actually see that to a value is given in centigrade which is converted correctly into Fahrenheit, they will develop faith that our Mr. Dumbo is actually a real life computer. The fact that there are many unknown things in this program and many cryptic things is all right at this stage. We'll tell them that during the course of teaching this subject over the semester, we will slowly but surely understand each and every sentence that is written in this program. In a nutshell, in one lecture, we have achieved the following important objectives. We have conveyed to our students that there is a very simple and accurate model of computer programming that is conveyed in terms of a Dumbo who can execute instructions. We have conveyed that the computer's memory consists of memory locations. We have conveyed that a location can contain only one value. We have conveyed that an input operation can change the value of a location. We have conveyed that an output operation does not change the value of a location. We have conveyed that the computation is done by Dumbo by copying numbers into a register and the resultant value goes back into a location. We have implicitly conveyed that an output of a string as an help can be carried out by Mr. Dumbo. And we have suddenly said that Mr. Dumbo is nothing but a model of a higher level programming language without explicitly mentioning so. We have conveyed the notion of a program. We have conveyed the notion that instructions in a program pre-written by us can be given to the computer or Mr. Dumbo, and Dumbo can store these instructions. We have subtly introduced the notion of instruction space and data space. Believe me, all of these are important concepts, and while people will not understand the very specifics of these details, but they will all understand and remember the fundamental notions that we have conveyed to them. I will end this session by two quizzes which I typically ask the students. This is the first quiz. Approximately how many different programming languages have been defined so far by computer scientists? We ask the students to guess, because many students who come to first year engineering have, some of them have actually done C, C++ programming or Java programming. Many of them have heard programming languages such as COBOL or Pascal or whatever. And therefore, it is interesting to ask them this question. Let me now go over to a particular location which was not there earlier. Let's go to Sona College, for example. Okay, since we don't have the clickers, let me ask you this question directly, visibly. I'll repeat the question. Approximately how many different programming languages have been defined so far by computer scientists? Option A, about 5 languages. Anybody for option A? Nobody. Okay, option B, 6 to 20 programming languages. Anybody for option B? No. Option C, 21 to 100 programming languages. Anybody for option C? Yes, I can see some hands being raised. Option D, more than 100 programming languages. Anybody for option D? Large number of people. However, it is interesting to see that some people have not raised hands for any one of the A to D options. That is not fair, because the question covers almost all possibilities. There is another college which claimed it, they have an answer. Can we go over to the other center, please? AAC Amrutapuri, they have an answer. Okay, Amrutapuri, what is the most popular option amongst the teachers assembled there? A, B, C or D?
D is the answer.
Answer is more than 100.
Yes, I hear you, but no, don't pass on the mic. I would like to ask you one more question. The first, the discipline that we have agreed to follow, you have to identify yourself and then only ask a question or answer a question. So may we all know your name, please.
Sir, I am Tushara.
Okay, Tushara, my question to you further is that when you say more than 100, can you guess how many programming languages would be there? Would it be 150, 200, 300, 1000, 5000?
Maybe more than 200,
300. Yes. Well, I'm happy that you actually tried to guess. Let me share this with all the participants across 22 centers. The exact number of computer programming languages, higher level programming languages, so far designed by computer scientists is not known. And that is because practically at every university or college, a researcher in computer programming languages ends up defining a new programming language, and some people, mostly his students, end up writing a compiler for that programming language. The last time I had done some count from historical books was in 1978 or 79, and at that time more than 600 programming languages were known to have been defined. Most of these higher level programming languages, however, die a natural death. Suppose I am a computer scientist at IIT Bombay, I will define a programming language, three of my students will implement it. After those three students pass out or have their PhD and go somewhere else, and after some time when I lose interest, that language definition, its compiler, etc., will quietly die away in my computers. What we must distinguish, and we must perhaps sometime tell our students, is that while there could be hundreds of higher level programming languages, and when I say hundreds, hundreds well-defined and well-implemented programming languages, the actual programming languages used are only a few. It is this usage part which is of interest to the students. That is the reason why you will find that when our students pass out their final year, and it does not matter whether they are computer science students, they could be students of any branch. In IIT, by the way, in IIT Bombay, some of the best programmers who have emerged in IIT in past two decades have not necessarily been computer science students. Notably, aerospace engineering, metallurgical engineering, mechanical engineering, chemical engineering, civil engineering have produced students who have become extremely competent programmers. So programming at higher level language is positively meant for students solving computing problem from any branch. And that is the point that we should emphasize, that all of them would tend to use a few programming languages based on certain criteria which we'll elaborate later in the course. Let me go over to the second question. Quiz 2 says the symbol backslash n in the instruction cout f backslash n will produce the following additional output. The word additional is used to distinguish between cout f and C out F and backslash N. So C out F would have produced the value of F, but C out F followed by backslash N will produce, we say A backslash N, B N, C nothing visible and end of line is inserted, and D I cannot guess. Please note of course that this question is not meant for colleague teachers who would automatically say C because that's the correct answer. But it is meant for our students who have never seen a backslash n in their life. Some of them may think that this will produce an output of n. Some of them will think that it will produce a string with backslash n. A few who will do programming will say nothing visible. Majority of them, however, should say, I cannot guess, because at this time, they have not been explained what a proper output instruction in C or C++ programming language is. So this is perfectly fine. Oh, Badnera is saying that they have an answer. Thank you very much, Badnera. Everybody amongst the audience has the correct answer. So we'll not bother going over to you. We'll instead have a break at this juncture.